My phone just beeped as I was getting up to preach. And I took a look at it. And this will excite my wife, because when we went down to Kenya, we came upon a hard nut to crack by the gospel nutcracker. She was Catholic. And when we started to visit with her, and the Catholics got wind that Adventists were visiting her, every time we went in and went out, they went in and they went out. And this week, the pastor called me to tell me that I got the strangest call today. Lillian called me and told me she's not ready. Amen. And just a while ago, the call came in, the beep came in, the text came in. Just baptized Lillian. Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Thank God for the wonder-working power of the Holy Spirit. May it be well with her soul. Next Sabbath, you will notice that for this quarter, we have been accentuating back to basics. Today I'm going to speak about back to the heart of worship. Next week's Sabbath, we're going to be going back to the need of prayer. I want this church next Sabbath to be transformed into a labor ward. Did anybody hear what I just said? I want us next week's Sabbath to agonize, to pray, to intercede, to badger heaven for the needs we have. Spiritual, physical, social, spiritual. We're going to pray next Sabbath. I'm telling you from now that the few minutes we spend each Sabbath in intercessory prayer is going to be expanded next week. Because we're going to pray for you, your children, your spouses, your grandchildren, your neighbor, your friends, our community. Next week's Sabbath, this place is going to be turned into a labor room. And we are going to travail till deliverance come. Amen. Sister Pat Langley will be with us. Amen. To speak next week Sabbath. And I'm putting you on notice that whatever need you have, bring it next week. Bring it next week. We are not even going to rush. Why did they turn me off? We are not even going to rush prayer next week. If you get nothing else out of worship next week, we are going back to the basics of prayer. On my best day, I need God as desperately as on my worst day. So we're going to pray. Pray till the power of the Lord come down. Today, back to the heart of worship. Take the word out, would you please? Take the word out, wherever you have it. Print or electronic, or mentally stored. And turn to the 96th division of the Psalm. And my anchor holds at verse 9. There's something very special about this text, Elder Johnson, because in my home church, the church of my childhood, when you walk through the door, written where you have reverenced my sanctuary, were the words of this text. Oh, worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Pastor Gregory spoke about holiness last week. Tremble before him, all the earth. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Lord, we come to worship you now. And I pray that as I open the word, that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart will be acceptable in your sight. For you are my Lord, my strength, my Redeemer. Amen. When you read the book of Psalms, it is filled with hundreds of poetic anthems and number of anthems that we sing find their origin in the Psalms. They were used in religious celebration. The children of Israel were instructed how to worship God. And as leader of worship here at the concourse, I think every now and again, I need to instruct you as to what worship is, so we can get back to the heart and the art of worship. Worship is not just congregating. It's the outpouring of our souls before Jehovah. Our true worship will be defined by the priority we place on God in our lives. Is God at the top of your priority list? You see, true worship is a matter of the heart, expressed through a lifestyle of holiness. True worship is a matter of the heart. You can't measure my worship. The thermometer for measuring my worship is in the hands of the Holy Spirit. It's a matter of the heart. But our lifestyle must express the beauty of holiness. We must be submissive to God. When we are, worship will become a non-negotiable item in the priority of your life. Oh, worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. We worship God because only God can be God. Only God is God. God is God because he's God by himself. The scripture says that we have God's many
But there is only one God who is God, and he transcends every other God. He loves us, and he loved us first. And because of what God has done for us, done with us, done in us, done through us, then we must worship him in the beauty of holiness. He's worthy of our praise. Angels in heaven adore him. They bow down before him and sing, "Holy, holy, holy, one for the Son, one for the Holy Ghost." Amen. And if angels can bow down before him in heaven and worship him, then those of us who are on earth should bow down before him and worship him. Verse 5 to 6 says, "All other gods are idols. But the God we worship, he made heaven and earth." Notice the distinction. Honor and majesty are before him. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. "Give unto the Lord, O families of the people, give to the Lord glory and strength. Give to the Lord the glory due to his name." The splendor is his. The majesty is his. The glory is his. The strength is his. And when we are in the sanctuary, we must come aflame with thanksgiving and praise, because we are worshiping the omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent one who alone deserves our total praise. And you come to worship God, focus on his worthiness and not your wealthiness. Many of us are good beggars. We come begging God. When we come, let's not come as beggars. Let's come as givers, giving him worship that is due to his name. Yeah, let him hear me. Yeah. Now let me tell you this. Worship is not the new phenomena that has overtaken Christendom. You go to some churches, they call it praise and worship. I like, and you should know that by now, that I like lively worship. I don't like graveside worship. I like lively worship. But I go to some churches and they call service praise and worship. The singing is great. People get a chance to gyrate. There is euphoria. And I am going to create a word. There is feel-goodism. Don't you think that's a good word? It will hit Webster's soon. Feel goodism. But ladies and gentlemen, that is not true worship. I found a text over here in Mark chapter 7, verse 6 and 7, that I want to read for you. And these are from the words of Jesus, the mouth of Jesus. "Well," he answered and said unto them, "did Isaiah prophesy of you hypocrites?" Now that's a word I don't like to use, because a hypocrite is somebody who is cloaked, somebody who is formicaed, somebody who is overshadowed The real stuff is beneath, not outside. The best definition of a hypocrite is somebody who pretends to be what they are not. And here is Jesus talking to religious people. Now, religious people are not necessarily spiritual people. They are spiritual people who are religious. But religiosity and spirituality are two totally different things. And Jesus detected that in the Pharisees and the scribes and the traditionalists and the purifierists. I've been around long enough to know that there are some people in church who are so earthly they are of no heavenly use. They are so heavenly they are of no earthly use. But they are formicaed. Yeah. I'm around long enough to know that not everyone who says, "Lord, Lord," knows the Lord. Jesus said, "Here are some people who honor me with their lips, mouth religion." Some people are good talkers, but poor doers. They worship me with their lips, but their heart is what? Far from me. Well, if Mark had said this, I would think he has some prejudices with the saints. But Jesus, are those words in red in your Bible? Jesus said. But the part that frightens me is verse 7. "And in vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrine the commandments of men." There is worship, and there is worship, and there is worship. A lot of people have lip worship, but what God wants is heart worship. Because a lot of people making a lot of noise and jumping and stamping and gyrating and tonguing. I mean, speaking in tongues. Holy gibberish. You would think they are so holy. But God says, if you don't do what I say the way I say you should do it, you are worshiping in vain. That is something I think we should soak in. That a lot of people go to church on the day of their choice to worship God and think the worship passes the roof, but it has not left the cleft of their palate. Jesus said something else about worship in John 4 and verse 23. Now let me read from verse 21. Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will neither on this mountain nor Jerusalem worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jew. But the hour is coming, and now is," listen to this, "when true worshipers will worship the Father in what? Spirit and in truth, for such the Father seeks to worship him." I paid very close attention to English in school. It was my favorite subject. And my English teacher, I had a wonderful English teacher, Curtis Wilmore Ward. He taught me that reading is not only what is printed, but you must also learn to read below the prints. And reading is not only what is said, reading is what is implied. So, if Jesus says that he desires true worship, he's also suggesting that there is false worship. And if we want to render true worship, if we want to get to the heart of worship, we must worship God in what? Spirit and in truth. For such the Father seeks to worship him. In other words, if you're not doing it in my spirit, and if you're not doing it in truth, forget about it. Last week they had Super Bowl, and I was listening on the radio one evening traveling home, and I heard a preacher saying, please turn up for Sunday morning worship. We are going to be finished service on time, and we're going to have a big screen so we can all watch Super Bowl together. He never said a word about the sermon he was going to preach. Super Bowl. Ladies and gentlemen, let's not use God's house as a commercial center. Let's not use God's house as a congregation of problems. Let's use God's house as a place of worship. True worship. Worship God in spirit and in truth. Listen to this. Worship God in spirit. Worship must not only be spirited, it must be spiritual. It must be a moment when our praise and our worship is God directed. It must be led by the Spirit and not us leading the Spirit. It must be a time when the Spirit of the living God falls afresh on us to melt us, to break us, to mold us. Worship must not be a time when we try to hype ourselves to say we are in the Spirit. Worship must be a time when the Spirit takes control of us and we walk and talk and live like Jesus lives. Some people like the hype and call it spirit. God seeks those who worship him to worship him in spirit and in truth. Suppose I tell you this, would you believe me? That it is not only God who is seeking worship, the devil also longs to be worshipped. You believe me? In Matthew chapter 4 and verse 9, he said to him all these things. Now, this one is intriguing because this is the devil talking to Jesus. And he said, all these things I will give you if you will do what? Fall down and worship me. Look at him. He said, I'll give you anything for you to worship me. The devil will do anything to get your worship. He'll make big offers to allure you, to attract you. He will even distract you from true worship. Don't you think if he did it to Jesus, he'll do it to you? Huh? And look at the rascal. He is even offering to give Jesus what does not belong to him. He's a scammer. Con man. I'll give you this. Giving Jesus what already belongs to Jesus. It's a long time. The devil has been wanting our worship. A long time. Over in Isaiah chapter 14 And verse 12 to 14, he says, the fall of Lucifer, how art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How are you cut down to the ground, you who weaken the nations? And listen to this now. I will ascend into the heavens. I will exalt the throne above God's throne. I will sit on the mountain of the congregation on the farthest side of the north. I will be like the Most High God. He wants worship. A long time he has been seeking it. And he's so egocentered. Worship should be God-centered, not self-centered. Are you hearing me out there? And the devil is so self-centered, full of ego, full of I will ascend to the heavens. That's far-sightedness. I will exalt my throne. I will sit on the mount of the congregation. And here it is. I will be like the Most High God. If I can't be better, I must at least be equal. You know, that type of ambition killed Caesar. And that type of ambition caused Lucifer heaven. Ladies and gentlemen, every eye disease that an optician can identify, Satan had it. Eye. Cataract. Myopia. Glaucoma, presbyopia, astigmatism, myopia, eye, until he became short-sighted and then blinded. He wants to be like the Most High God. Why does he want to be like the Most High God? So that people can come and worship him. The devil wants to be the center of attraction. He wants to draw attention to God. I went to a particular city to preach, and the Adventist church didn't have its own building, and so they rented a church called the First Church of Lucifer. And I drove up the morning and saw the sign. And then below it I saw a little thing they put down here. Seventh-day Adventist and an arrow pointing in. And I looked up again and I saw the First Church of Lucifer. And I looked down and I saw Adventist. And I wonder what contradiction. And I preached that day with such discomfort in the First Church of the Devil. And it might shock you to know that there is a religion called the Church of the Devil. And it is full. There are people who have membership in the First Church of the Devil, worshiping him because he has promised to scam and take care of them. Let in our worship draw people to Christ. Let us not even try to be the star in worship. Let Jesus be high and lifted up. Because he says, when I am high and lifted up, what will I do? I will draw all people unto me. Some services are star-studded. You know. They bring in great motivational speakers. They bring in great actors, Grammy Award winning singers. They bring in celebrities. And when they come to town, church is packed. But when Jesus comes to town, he can hardly get an audience. Worship him. Worship him, Jesus Christ the Lord. Let's not give the worship that belongs to God, to the devil. Let's put God back into the center of worship. When God is in the center of worship, there'll be no interference. You worship him with your entire being. Worship will be spontaneous. Nothing will come between your soul and the Savior. It will be God and God alone. As I was preparing this message this week, I like to play music, and I just happened to be playing a certain music, and it was on YouTube. And YouTube, when on that particular program, when one song is finished, it goes on to another and another. And I was locked away wrestling with this message, and I heard the songs playing. God and God alone created all these things we call our own, from the mighty to the small. The glory in them all is God and God alone. So I Googled it and I found the words, God and God alone is fit to take the universe's throne. Let everything that lives reserve its truest praise for God and God alone. God and God alone reveals the truth of all we call unknown. And the best and worst of man won't change the master's plan. For it's God and God alone. God and God alone is fit to take the universe's throne. Let him that lives reserve its truest praise. For it's God and God alone. Let's reserve our highest praise for God and God alone. Jesus said that when we worship him, we must worship him in spirit and in truth. Worship him in spirit and in truth. The source for truth in worship is the Word of God, not catechism. Not church book, not church manual, the Word of God. And you know the woman at the well, the Samaritan woman, recited to Jesus a worship controversy in her days. She wanted to find out from Jesus which temple was the proper one in which to worship. Was it the temple built by the Jews in Jerusalem, or was it the temple built by the Samaritans at Mount Gerizim? But Jesus said, don't go there. Don't go there. The hour is coming when you neither in the mountain nor at Jerusalem will worship the Father. You are worshiping and you don't even know what you're worshiping. But God is a spirit. And they that worship him, true worship comes from God. Now talking about, back to my English teacher, not just what the text says, but also what it didn't say. Jesus didn't say, it doesn't matter. Worship matters. He didn't say, oh, it's not important. Worship is important. He didn't say, well, I don't know, and there is no way to know. No. He didn't say, I'm not going to answer that. I'm going to plead the fifth on it because I don't want to appear to be overcritical and well-intentioned and too sincere. He didn't say it doesn't matter because we are all worshiping the same God. No, we are not. That's one of the big excuses that our brothers on the other side of the tracks say to us when we tell them about our faith. Oh, it doesn't matter. We are worshiping the same God. Brothers and sisters, if we were all worshiping the same God, we would be doing the same thing. But note what Jesus said. Our fathers worship in the mountains. You as Jews worship in Jerusalem. And Jerusalem is the place where you ought to worship. Jesus was very specific in referring to a specific type of worship. When I did what was called Greek exegesis, and that's simple, looking at the text within its context and what the original language said, this is one of the passages that we had to exegete. My department chair, W. Campbell, he liked us to understand text in context. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. He said to us, don't go out and tell the brethren that. It means nothing to them because they don't even know what a spirit is. So the original language there says, God is invisible, and they that worship him must do so in respect of his invisibility. You can't see him, but you know he's there. And when you come before him, there must be a mighty awe. There must be reverence. You must salute him, the King of Glory. When President Trump steps off Air Force One, the boys salute him. When God steps down in concourse, we must salute him. We can't see him, but he's here. You might have heard the story about a good Christian boy who left home and went to university to study. And a lot of people lose their faith at university. They gain degrees that are not on the thermometer. When your kids leave for college, pray for them. He went to school and he began to hear some things he never heard before, and they affected his mind. And on his first semester break, he went home and he sought to educate his mother. Mama, he said, all those things that you used to teach me about God, do you know this God thing is just a figment of the imagination? Now, be careful what you tell your mother. Some of them will kill them. I said, Mama, there is no such thing as God. He said, I learned this semester in college that anything that is must be tangible, must be touchable, must be seeable. And it almost shattered Mama's nerves. Mama would not so much as try to respond. She went to her room and she prayed. And she went to bed a troubled woman. And during the hours of the night, she heard a screaming coming from her boy's room. As good mothers would. She jumped up to run down there to see what was happening to her boy. And when she knocked and he said, come, and she went in, he was overpowered with pain. He was wriggled with pain. A toothache had come up on him out of nowhere. He had never had a toothache like that before. Anybody here ever had a toothache? And he screamed and cried, and he screamed and cried. And Mama said, what's wrong, son? He said, Mama, I've got a toothache and it pains so badly. He said, let me see it, son. Let me see the pain. And the boy said, Mama, don't get stupid, Mama. Can you see pain? And Mama said, Son, anything that's tangible should be seen. You told me early on there was no God because you can't see him and you can't feel him. How do you know you have a toothache? Mama, I have a toothache. I feel it all over my body, not just in my mouth. I feel it, Mama. I can't explain it, but I have it. Say, well, son, I can't explain to you God, but every now and again, I just feel him moving in my body. I feel him all over me. We can't see him, but he's there. Worship him in spirit, from the heart, in respect to his invisibility. Worship him in truth as directed in his word. Our lifestyle must reflect our worship. This is not optional. This is vital. You can't live like hell all week and expect to get heaven during divine hour. Somebody heard me? You can't fill your mind with darkness all week and expect light at divine hour. You can't worship yourself all week and be affectionate to God for 2 hours, and when I go over 1 o'clock, you get sidetracked. Who you are speaks so loud the world cannot hear what you're saying. You can't afford all week at the workplace to be dressed like modern Jezebels and expect on Sabbath to be like gentle Jesus, meek and mild. We've got to get back to the heart of worship. And don't lie to the world. And don't misrepresent God. God is seeking true worshipers who worship him according to his revealed will. Genuine worshipers. You must begin with a desire for holiness. And a desire to be in the presence of God. I'm reading the book called Great Prayers of the Bible by a man called E.M. Bounds. Pastor, this one is not for them, it's for us. Because when I was preparing this message and came upon this quotation, I put down my pen and I leaned back. You want me to read it for you?
Yes.
Now, this one is serious, you know.
Yes, yes.
Pastor, just for me and you.
Yes.
The sermon cannot rise in its life-giving force above the man. Dead men will give dead sermons, and dead sermons kill. We're doing the Bible here, and we're going through Leviticus, Numbers, and we're studying the life of the priest. And boy, have I become aware how unworthy I am. Dead preachers giving dead sermons. Dead sermons kill. He continues. Everything on the spiritual character of the preacher, who he is all week, will tell who he is when he steps into the pulpit. Every now and again, I have to preach to myself. The passion and the conviction of his message is only as strong as the passion and conviction within himself. Your sermon will never convert others if it can't convert you. My God. He said, out of the abundance of your heart, your mouth speak. And if you have nothing to speak, it is because nothing is in your heart. That's true for you too. You cannot be a Christian weakness if you are absorbed in your weakness. What goes around comes around. Genuine worship must begin with a desire for holiness. A desire to be in the presence of God and overpowered by his presence. Genuine worship involves and generates heartfelt forgiveness and reconciliation. You know, Matthew 5 and verse 23 says, listen, if you bring your gift to the altar and there remember that your brother has something against you, not if you have something against your brother. If your brother has something against you, leave your gift before the altar and go and reconcile with your brother. Then come back and offer me your worship. True worship. I soon be done. True worship encourages us to fix broken relationships before we come to worship. It's a key ingredient. In short, when we don't fix broken relationships, it become critical, divisive. When you don't forgive, it releases bitterness, anger, hurt. You'll never experience freedom because you can't sleep well. Pain, resentment. You can't worship God the way you should because there's a boulder between you and God. And if you want to worship God in spirit and in truth, there are some broken relationships that you've got to fix. Let Ephesians 4:31 say, let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as what God in Christ's name has forgiven you. That's getting back to the heart of true worship. When you see me at the door and shake my hand and hug me, you must not have a dagger at my back. When you see me and smile with me, it must not just be a spiritual grin. It must be from the heart. When we come together as brethren, there must be no friendly fire. Simply stated, bitterness and negativity and anger hinder genuine worship. So take the time right now. Take the time this Sabbath, the last Sabbath of February. You might never see another last Sabbath in February. Take the time now and repent of these destructive attitudes if they exist. Call somebody that you haven't spoken to for a long time. If you can't talk to them, write them and fix it. Ask for forgiveness if it is warranted. Even in families, some family member haven't spoken for years because of deadlift. Pray. Seek restoration. Some supposed sleep in the same bed. I was in a district one, pastoring, and in the middle of Friday night, I heard a car horn outside my gate, outside my door, wondering in the middle of the night. In the heat of the night. You remember that show on TV? And it was one of my elders. And he said, "Pastor, come with me. Come. So what happened? He said, "Just come. Well, I trusted my elder. I said, "What is it?" And all the drive we're driving, I said, "What's happening?" He said, "It's something you got to see. I can't explain." Drove with him. He drove up in his driveway. And he led me inside. And when he led me inside, he led me to his bedroom. I was a little hesitant because I needed to respect the privacy of his wife. So I just wondered if anything had happened to her. So I crawled and I went up. And I said, "What is it?" And he said, look, Pastor, how am I going to live with this? How am I going to live with this? In the middle of the bed, there was a piece of board. And she on one side, and he on the other side. I was a young pastor. I could perhaps be his grandson. And I didn't know what to say or to do. And before I could say anything, she woke up and looked at me and she said, "We better lock him in the bed at all." Brothers and sisters, those two people, when you see them in church, you would have thought they were cherubims from the throne of God. But in their house, there was no peace, agony, bitterness, division. And the story ends very sadly that about 6 weeks later, I buried the wife because she died from a heart attack. And the two of them never made it right. I come to tell my people today to make it right. Because if you're not right with your fellow men, you cannot be right with God. Prayers will not go beyond your roof. We have a wonderful church here with some nice people. But I've been in places, folks. I've been to places. I've pastored places. I've pastored 40 churches. I've been to places
where when you see some men step out on Sabbath in their suit and some ladies in their dress and hot, you say, yeah, yeah, GQ, yeah. But you would never know the hell that goes on behind closed doors. And those are the people who come to church to give the pastor hell. Because that's the only place they get to show off themselves. At home, the cock keeps quiet and the hen does the crowing. Repentance must take place. That's why we come to church. That's what makes us different from the world. Let no bitter root grow up to cause anything to defile us. If you want to get back to the heart of worship, there must be forgiveness. There must be restoration. There must be repentance. We must swallow our pride. Because I tell you this, the only persons that this affect is you. You. So, finally, my brethren. The great controversy started over worship. And it's going to end over worship. Worship caused Earth's first murder. There are people who are so fanatical, they'll kill you if you don't act like them and be like them and believe like them. You see that happening in the Earth now? There are people who rather worship the creature rather than the creator. But when we want to worship God in spirit and in truth, we must remember that the creator has preeminence over the created. As Seventh-day Adventists, never forget this, that we have become light bearers in this world to bring people back to the heart of worship. It's a part of our legacy. It's a part of our philosophy. It's a part of our theology. It's a part of our fundamental beliefs. In Revelation 14, we preach about angels flying mid-heavens, having the everlasting gospel to preach to those who dwell on the earth. Nobody excluded. Every nation, every kindred, every tribe, every tongue, every people group. We are called by God to bring an end time message to them, and it's a message about worship. Here's the message. Fear God. Give glory to him. The hour of his judgment has come. Not is coming, nor came. It's here. We are living in judgment hour. Did somebody hear me here today? Judgment hour. And Peter, old Pete, said judgment must begin in the house of God. And he went on to ask a question that we call in Greek rhetorical, probative,
It's not intended to get an open answer because only you can answer it. If judgment begins at the house of God, we call this logical reasoning. If judgment begins at the house of God, and it is going to be so bad in the house of God, what is going to happen to those who know not God? The hour of the judgment has come. And what must we do? Worship him who made heaven and earth, the sea, the fountain of water. What distinguishing mark? You notice which God we must worship? One who made heaven, earth, the mountain, the fountains of water. Water. Worship, worship. And I look down at verse 9, and he said, if anyone worship the other man, the beast, his image, he is going to receive a mark. Everybody's going to get a mark. Those who worship God will get a mark of approval. And those who worship the devil will get a mark. On his forehead and in his hand. And God say he's going to get an extra special gift because he's going to drink of the wine of the wrath of God poured out without mixture in the cup of his indignation. And he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of holy angel and in the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of his torment shall ascend to heaven, and he's going to have no rest day or night. Who worshiped the beast and his image? But he says to those who worship God, here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that do what? Keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus. Well, I'm not a star-studded preacher. I never take claim to fame. And my sermon might not even be homiletically on point. But let me tell you what I came here today to tell you. Get back to the heart of worship. Reverence God. Honor God. Obey God. Pay homage to God. Nothing the devil offers you, must you take it as a bribe. Give glory to God. Acknowledge him as the only true God. Set up pure worship in your heart. Praise him as the ruler of heaven. Worship him because he made heaven and earth, the true God, the creator of all things. Yes, worship him. And if you have anything in your heart that is blocking your worship, ask him for heart surgery. And get back to the heart of worship. Because it's all about you, God. It's all about you. I'm sorry, Lord, for the things I've made. When it was not about you, but it's now all about you. King of endless worth, no one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, all I have is yours. Every single breath I'll bring. You're more than a song, for a song itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within through the way things appear. You look into my heart. And Michael Smith says, I'm coming back to the heart of worship. It's all about you. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. It's all about you.